a good afternoon session with the second talk by Membrez. It will be about the criterion for generation of supply category given by Abouzaid.
Thank you very much, Jake. So, yeah, that's the title of the talk, Abouzaid Split Generation Criterion. And so I'll start off by just writing down the statement, and then I'll explain how we'll proceed. So in this case, we take M to be our Louisville manifold. And now we take W to be a subcategory. I'm actually just going to write down the statement, and then I'll explain how we proceed. So. I'm just going to write down a couple of words, and then eventually, I hope, understanding will build up.
It's a kind of symplectic
manifold. So W is a subcategory of the wrapped Foucault category of M with finite objects, or with a finite number of objects. And now we can state the theorem. So the theorem goes as follows. If we have B, a full subcategory of W, and furthermore, if we have the assumption that if the image of the following map, which maps from the Hochschild homology of B with coefficients in itself into the Hochschild homology of W with coefficients in itself, and if this maps into the symplectic cohomology of the manifold, this map is given via the open-closed map. I'll write it like this, H star OC. Okay. So if this map hits the identity, which is a canonical element in here, then the subcategory B split generates the category W. Okay, so this is a statement, and I think a lot of things are.
The last error, does it always hit identity?
Oh, no, no, not at all.
Not B, but you should
say. Uh-huh, not necessarily. No. Oh, because, I mean, W is a finite, has a finite number of objects.
Yeah. Okay.
So first of all, I'd like to explain what the wrapped Foucault category of a Liouville manifold is. After that, I'll explain, well, try to make a brief explanation of the necessary homological algebra that we'll use in this case. So I'll give another characterization of split generation, which is possibly different from the one we heard this morning by Nati. And then I'll explain what symplectic cohomology is. I'll explain what the open-closed map is. And eventually, I'll give a sketch of the proof of the theorem. Okay, so that's the basic order for this talk. Okay.
Yeah. What is a full subcategory?
It's when the morphism spaces are the same ones as in the category. Okay, so let's start off with the wrapped Foucault category. So yesterday we saw the Foucault category of an exact manifold, exact symplectic manifold, and in that case we looked at compact Lagrangians. Yeah.
So what is the claim? So if the image of this map is
if it hits, identity. There we go. Sorry. So there's a canonical element in the symplectic homology called the identity. I'll explain where that comes from later. But if it hits this element, then B split generates W. Okay. So yeah, as I was saying yesterday, we looked at compact Lagrangians. And in the Rapfu category, we also consider non-compact Lagrangians. And this will bring some difficulties with it. So the setting is that M is an exact Liouville manifold. With a cylindrical end. So this means we can write M as the union of a compact part. A compact part has a boundary, which we'll write by del Mn. And it has a cylindrical end, which is of the form this boundary times 1, the interval with infinite length.
So, one second, what's the point of putting this extra category W in? I'd just like to say that it generates the whole category.
Yeah. So well, I think.
And certainly,
I didn't quite understand where this finite subcondition comes from. On W, but it's written in his paper this way, so.
No, but it does, the statement doesn't say at all about the fourth category. It says about some W.
Yeah, about a finite subcategory with a finite
the
number of objects.
This map from HH doesn't, I mean, it factors through HH W, 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 but I mean, it's going to map canonically to, there's also an open-closed map from BB to ASH. And
yeah, I mean, that's precisely this map, yeah.
It's the same thing.
It's the same thing, yeah.
First going to HH of W.
Exactly, yeah.
And then going to SH. Yeah. So, I mean...
Well, I can erase that.
This hitting the identity doesn't have to do with W at all. So you could just take any finite subcategory.
Wait a sec.
That any object in the Foucault category, for example, would then be
generated by... Wait a sec, what am I getting wrong?
What has been Foucault? It just means morphisms are the same.
Yeah, morphisms are the same, yeah.
So do you know why this W is like... Why is it this W in this
field? Well, I mean, it's... As opposed to...
Just saying the whole...
Lagrangians. I see that W.
Couldn't you just say like the whole Foucault category? Instead, I mean, why do you have to strip to a subcategory?
That's true.
B had to have a finite number. No, I don't. I'm not sure about
it. It would seem from the way this is stated that you could just get any Lagrangian at all.
Yeah.
You can also set it to W.
Right. So then it's every single object is. I think essentially what it's supposed to say is that if you can hit the identity, you generate the whole thing.
Okay, that's it.
Okay, so we'll take W to be WFM.
Yeah.
Okay, so. So we look at this Liouville manifold with a cylindrical end.
Liouville just means then omega is exact. Yes.
Omega is exact, and we also have a Liouville vector field that's outward pointing. So draw an image. This would be MIN. This would be the cylindrical end. And so this vector field, I call it Z lambda. This is the Liouville vector field. So if we plug this into omega, this gives us lambda.
Yeah.
Okay. And we want it to be outward pointing. Okay. And furthermore, on the cylindrical part, we want z lambda to be of the form r d r. where R is the coordinate in the interval. Okay. Yeah.
Z lambda is part of the data on the
manifold? Yeah, it's part of the data on the manifold.
So same manifold with different Z lambdas are different manifolds?
They can possibly be.
And second question, where exactly does Z lambda live in the tangent space of which manifold?
The N.
Of N.
It's a vector field on N.
And you require that Z lambda is R.
On the cylindrical end.
Lambda, you need to return to
So this means that this boundary here.
All that is omega and lambda.
Yeah. Mm. Change lambda.
Okay. So this boundary, with this restriction of lambda, is a contact manifold. So okay, so some more notation. I denote by psi rho. This is the Liouville flow. And here rho is, well, it's Liouville flow for time log t. Log rho, sorry. Okay, t is equal to log rho. And now we look at the following set of Lagrangians. So we take the Lagrangians L and M to be as follows. We want L to be exact. And now we let these Lagrangians be non-compact. And so we impose the condition that they're cylindrical at infinity. So this means that if lambda restricted to L is of an exact form, then this FL has compact support. Okay. Yeah. Oh no, wait, sorry. DFL has compact support. There we go. Lagrangians? The Liouville flow.
The rest?
For the time log rho. Okay.
For time log
rho. This is. So, psi, I mean, the Liouville vector field defines a flow, and then you flow for time log rho.
Okay. Rho is just a number?
Rho is just a number. So, what this does is it means that psi rho of an element of your cylindrical end gets mapped to rho times r. Of x.
Now, I don't understand what you mean. Lambda is restricted. Essentially, you want lambda restricted to L as compact support.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And so now, the problem is that our Lagrangians, they're non-compact. And so, we saw yesterday, so this is some Lagrangian, we saw yesterday that if we have a compact Lagrangian, we can choose a Hamiltonian with compact support such that this Hamiltonian moves this Lagrangian away from itself so that the intersections become transversal. And this doesn't work in this case because Lagrangians are non-compact. So we have to choose a set of Hamiltonians which can basically move our non-compact Lagrangians. So we define the set of admissible Hamiltonians. So H is an admissible Hamiltonian.
Is it equivalent to the condition of the Lagrangian being cylindrical? It's just equivalent from some t onwards, it becomes like a
exactly. Yeah.
A product.
So it becomes, so the Lagrangian intersected with this contact manifold is a Legendrian submanifold. And so it's based, it's just the product of the interval with this Legendrian submanifold. Okay. That's important. Okay. So H is an admissible Hamiltonian. H goes from M to R. And we require that this admissible Hamiltonian satisfies the following, namely H of Rx is equal to R squared outside of a compact set. Okay. So this Hamiltonian gives us a vector field, which is the Hamiltonian vector field. This is defined as follows. DH is equal to omega XH. So it's uniquely defined. And yeah, okay. So note that outside of this compact subset, since this Hamiltonian is of the form R squared, this implies that XH is then equal to 2R R alpha. Oh, wait. Where R alpha is the Reeve vector field of the contact form on the boundary. Okay. So alpha is the contact form on the boundary of the compact subset M.
Is alpha the same as lambda?
Yeah, alpha is lambda restricted to. Okay. There we go. Okay. So now we have the time one flow of XH. It's phi 1 of H. And so now we just pick two Lagrangians and we can define the set of Hamiltonian orbits between these two Lagrangians. So for two Lagrangians, L0 and L1, we pick a Hamiltonian such that the Hamiltonian flow maps L0 to a transversal intersection of L1. And then we define x L0 L1 to be as follows. Yeah.
The Reeve vector field that's associated to a contact form, is it lambda or alpha or alpha?
Alpha is lambda restricted to. So the Hamiltonian chords are just these maps from 0, 1 to M, such that gamma dot is equal to XH, composed of gamma of 0 is in L0, gamma of 1 is in L1. Okay. So this is precisely, these are precisely the generators of our wrapped Fleur complex. So CW of L0, L1, and now we include the information on the Hamiltonian, is then precisely the direct sum over all these elements, gamma. And we pick a field, K, gamma. Okay, so now note the following, that as Nick explained yesterday, we can define a grading on these elements. So this is actually a graded complex. And yeah, okay, this only holds if we have further assumptions on the symplectic manifold, well, depending on the grading we want. And maybe something else of importance is that this set of Hamiltonian chords, what it does is it contains the perturbed intersection points in the compact subset of M, plus Reeve chords in the cylindrical part. Okay. Yeah?
Could you explain the last part except about Reeve chords?
Okay, so with this Hamiltonian, we can look at these Hamiltonian chords in the cylindrical part, and since the vector field is given precisely by the Reeve vector flow, Reeve vector field, so this means that in the cylindrical part, we just get Reeve chords, or reparametrized Reeve chords. The reason I'm saying this is because if we only consider the compact part, we can look at compact Lagrangians, which are contained inside here, and then we get precisely this definition from yesterday, where we have these intersection points, or in this case, perturbed intersection points. And so now for the differential, U1 goes from C L0 L1 H to itself. So what we have to do here is we first pick a family JT in the space of omega compatible almost complex structures in 0, 1. And now we defined the moduli space of perturbed J holomorphic disks, J holomorphic strips. So if I take two elements gamma 0 and gamma 1 in this Raptor complex, I define M gamma 0 and gamma 1 as follows. I take this U to be R cross 0, 1 into M, so that U has one boundary in L0, the other boundary lies in L1, and it satisfies this perturbed J holomorphic equation. So the 0, 1 part is taken with respect to this choice of almost complex structure. And furthermore, we have the asymptotic condition that this strip goes to gamma 0 when s goes to minus infinity, and it goes to gamma 1 when s goes to infinity. So u goes to gamma 0. Okay, so, furthermore, we also have an R action on the space, where we just translate these strips by R in the S direction. Yeah. Okay. So now, once again, we have this result that, assuming our assumptions are, well, our choices are generic, then this moduli space of strips between gamma 0 and gamma 1 is a smooth manifold of dimension degree of gamma 0 minus degree of gamma 1 minus 1. Okay. And so, yeah. Here we have this grating that I mentioned before. Okay, so a nice picture. It's gamma 0, gamma 1. This is a strip. And we define the differential mu 1 of gamma 1 to be precisely the number over all gamma 0, such that this moduli space has has dimension 0. And then we count the points in this moduli space, gamma 0, gamma 1. Times gamma 0.
Yep. You say we have a family of complex structures.
Yeah.
So how exactly does that fit into this?
0, 1. So this can be actually, well, this is equivalent to the equation where you have ds of u plus jt dt of u is equal to x, h. Okay. Okay.
What is the degree of the Cayetano?
The degree? I think Nick talked about it yesterday when we looked at these, the degree of generators of.
Yes, we didn't define it. It's defined using the Maslow index.
So, I can probably explain that afterwards if we have some time. Okay. Okay, great. So, first of all, note that this is a finite sum. And this is precisely where this choice of admissible Hamiltonian comes in. So because for such Hamiltonians, we can get, we see that if we take these chords to go further out on the cylindrical end, then these perturbed holomorphic SIPs will eventually have negative energy, which excludes their existence. And this is how we get a finite sum. And using this, we get the wrapped Fleur cohomology. Of L0 and L1, HW stars L0, L1.
So your local origin, they're just kind of sub space trap cohomology. Change some. Is it a compatible character?
Yeah.
You also can.
Then you get the wrapped Fleur cohomology of these compact Lagrangians. Is that what I explained yesterday, yeah, the usual.
Is the usual cohomology embedded in the Rapka?
Yeah, so to speak.
So I mean, for like a non-compact Lagrangian, though, the usual Fleur cohomology is not Hamiltonian invariant.
Yeah, no, I understand. But you have a map, basically, of usual cohomology to Rapka.
So I mean, for a non-compact Lagrangian, it's not really well defined.
No, but you take compact Lagrangian, so you have F of M, and then you can. So this is the code.
Whether you have disk or something, which can go to infinity. When you compute disk, do you allow them to go to infinity?
No, they don't go to infinity.
They kind of meet these Reeve orbits that go farther and farther out, though, which makes sense. Between compact Lagrangians, it's just it stays.
There is a map from cohomology of the Lagrangian to its endomorphism algebra in the wrapped Foucaille category, which is a map of algebras, not necessarily integral.
Okay. Exactly. So basically, on the space of chords, not necessarily Hamiltonian, that go from L0 to L1, you can define an action functional. And what we're doing is Morse theory for this action functional. And what happens is if your chords go further and further away, if you take Hamiltonian chords that go further and further away, then your action functional becomes negative. It becomes smaller, goes to minus infinity. And this gives you an energy bound because the energy of, a defined energy of these perturbed holomorphic strips contains the expression for the action value of this chord. So that's kind of like the basic idea. Okay, sure. So this is the Fleur cohomology, and let me quickly explain what happens when we look at composition maps. Okay. So we want to define an infinity structure. So we take mu d, once again, to go from Cw, Ld minus 1, Ld, tends to Cw, L0, L1, Cw, L0, Ld. And so here the idea is that we take a disk, call it S. We have a bunch of punctures. Okay. And so this is biholomorphic to something that looks like this. Basically to a disk with, we can choose strip-like ends so that all these punctures correspond to such strip-like ends. And so we map this disk into our manifold. Such that these maps are asymptotic to these Hamiltonian chords. Okay, and so we require these maps, call this map U, to satisfy perturb J holomorphic equation. So du minus xh tilde tensor alpha 0, 1 is supposed to be equal to 0. Okay, so now I have to make some remarks. So first we choose perturbation data.
What is alpha here?
Yeah, that's what I'm about to say.
It's not the same alpha.
It's not the same alpha, so we'll take beta. Have I used beta? No, I don't think so. Okay, so first of all, h tilde, we have to make a choice for perturbation data, and we do this by choosing a function that goes from S into the space of admissible Hamiltonians. Okay. So I didn't denote this. Let's call this space H of M, space of admissible Hamiltonians. Okay. This is one part of our perturbation data. And then we need a one form beta, an omega one of S. Okay. And we also have to make a choice of almost complex structure, J, which goes from S to JM. And so this, so these are our choices of perturbation data. And yeah, and so now, since we're in the non-compact case, we want to make sure that we only get, for a given configuration of Hamiltonian chords, that we only get finitely many such perturbed, well, J holomorphic disks. Yeah.
I don't understand. For every point in a disk, you assign a different Hamiltonian.
Exactly.
And how does that come to play with the perturbation of the Lagrangian?
You move.
So, okay. So, okay. So if you consider this to be the boundary of one Lagrangian, and this to be the boundary of another Lagrangian, what you do is you pick from L0 to L1, you pick a Hamiltonian, which, yeah, in the Raptler complex, okay? You use that Hamiltonian to define these Hamiltonian chords. And when you look at maps from the disk into your manifold, you want the perturbation data, H tilde, to match the perturbation data of the chosen Fleur complex around these punctures.
So you're kind of interpolating between all those?
Exactly, yeah.
What is the role of beta?
The role of beta is, well, first of all, you want a one form. And so beta is basically supposed to interpolate between the one forms dt on these ends. Okay. So imagine if you have a strip like n, it can be seen as 0, 1 times an infinite interval. On this strip like n, you have a one form dt. And you see that if beta, well, if this perturbation data satisfies what I said before, namely that around these punctures, it corresponds to the chosen perturbation data of these, of the Fleur complexes, then you see that these disks converge precisely to these Hamiltonian chords. Okay. Is this understandable, or am I losing somebody? Okay. And so note that this beta, actually, since we want this energy estimate, So that we only have finitely many of these perturbed disks, we have to ask for d beta to be smaller than or equal to 0. Okay, and what? So okay. The differential of the form is negative on the whole disk.
Without J, it doesn't make sense. With J, it could make sense. This one
so what's a positive line bundle? It has curvature, like a
kind
of. Positive, like a
kind of. No, FJ, then.
Oh, but it's a Riemann surface, S.
Okay.
So you have a complex structure there.
Okay.
Okay. And so, well, maybe I should try to summarize this point on perturbation data. So basically, for this energy estimate, so you want a finite number of such perturbed disks in your moduli space. You need this condition, but this condition doesn't quite match up with the perturbation data on the ends. Okay. And so what you do there is you, how do I explain this? So you look at rescaled Hamiltonian chords at the ends. It turns out that these Hamiltonian chords lie in a complex that's naturally isomorphic to the original Fleur complex, and you now consider disks that have these asymptotic conditions that go to these rescaled Hamiltonian chords, and furthermore have moving boundary conditions along the Lagrangian. And this gives you a well-defined map on these wrapped Fleur complexes. Okay. So, okay. So I'll just write, use rescaled Hamiltonian chords. So the rescaling is given by the Liouville flow. And by defining new moduli spaces that go towards these, well, that have asymptotic conditions that converge towards these rescaled Hamiltonian chords, we get a well-defined object. And this gives us well-defined composition maps. Okay. So once again, we get an A-infinity category where the objects are exact Lagrangians, but in this case, they can be non-compact. Okay. Yes?
What problem does the scaling
solve? So, okay, so we have to have this condition, d beta has to be smaller than or equal to 0. We need this for a finite energy estimate because we don't want infinitely many such perturbed J-holomorphic disks. But this condition actually contradicts the fact that we already have prescribed perturbation data near the ends. Okay. Okay. And so in order to remedy the situation, we have to change the perturbation data slightly, and we do that by looking at other Hamiltonian chords, which we get by this rescaling of the Liouville form, of the Liouville flow. Okay. And this gives us well-defined composition maps. Okay, so yeah. So this gives us the wrapped Foucault category. And now I'd like to explain the definition of split generation that I'll be using. Okay. So, okay. So once again, A is our A-infinity category, and we're not going to go through the definitions, but associated to this A-infinity category, we have categories of A-infinity modules, left modules, right modules, and bimodules. I'll write them by A mod, mod A, and A, A, mod. So this is just the category of left A infinity modules over A. And now we have a Yoneda embedding. And so the left Yoneda embedding takes the objects of your A-infinity category into A mod. The right Yoneda embedding takes your objects of your A-infinity category into mod A. And these embeddings are defined as follows. So YL of K, where K is an object of A, is defined to be the morphism space of A. Okay. So we have to choose an object X, and YR of K, X is defined to be the morphism space of X and K. Okay. And so in these categories, these are actually differential graded categories. We also have tensor products. And as Nati explained this morning, we also have a notion of Hochschild homology for A infinity categories with coefficients in bimodules. Did you? Okay. So I think I have to cut this part on homological algebra short because there's a time constraint. But, yeah. So, there's a notion of Hochschild homology of A infinity categories with coefficients in bimodules. Well, this is an AA bimodule. Okay. And now let me write down the definition of split generation in the setting. Okay. So here, W is an A infinity category. B is a subcategory. And so we say that B split generates W if for every object K in W, the following holds, namely the Yoneda module associated to K, Y L K, or I chose this notation, Y L K. So this admits a cohomologically left invertible morphism into a twisted complex. Of Yoneda modules. Of B. So we just take our subcategory B and we look at the image under the Yoneda embedding in the category of Yoneda modules, of modules over W. Okay. So now, yeah, exactly. Precisely. Okay. So let me move on to the definition of symplectic cohomology. So symplectic cohomology is basically, well, is a version of Hamiltonian fluorhomology for open manifolds. So in Hamiltonian fluorhomology, we look at periodic Hamiltonian orbits, and we define a differential between these periodic orbits by looking at J allomorphic cylinders between these orbits. And
do you put any conditions on symplectic manifold?
Here, yes. Yeah. I'm talking about, okay. So in Hamiltonian fluorhomology for compact manifolds, for compact symplectic manifolds, everything works out fine. You have these periodic orbits, and then you have these cylinders between them. So here we're actually looking at, once again, at Liouville manifolds, M is equal to omega j lambda. And so now we have to, so if you want to define Hamiltonian fluorhomology for this case, we have to have a condition on these Hamiltonians. So once again, we pick our Hamiltonian to be admissible, which means that it has quadratic growth at infinity. So H.
And what is it, quadratic growth? It's exactly quadratic growth.
It's exactly quadratic. No, exactly quadratic. outside of a compact set, it's R squared. Okay. And okay. So yeah. So what we do is we choose now a perturbation of this admissible Hamiltonian. F goes from S1 cross M to R. And what this perturbation does is that if we look at periodic orbits that come from the Hamiltonian vector field of H, they actually come in S1 families. And so with this perturbation F, we try to destroy this S1 invariance. So we consider G to be the sum of H plus F. We take the Hamiltonian vector field of G, okay? And then we look at the periodic orbits of the Hamiltonian vector field of G. Okay. So we have the defining set. So gamma goes from S1 to M. Gamma prime is given by XG plus with gamma. This is our periodic orbit of G. And we define this to be the generators of our symplectic complex. Okay. So the Hamiltonian only depends on the point in the manifold. So you can basically choose any point where you start on the loop. And that gives you an S1 family.
Ah.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. And so the idea is, as before, to choose this family of almost complex structures. And then you define the moduli space of perturbed J holomorphic cylinders between these orbits. So M, gamma 0, gamma 1. So you have this perturbation du minus xg times dt 0, 1. This is equal to 0. And u goes for s to infinity, it goes towards gamma 1. And for s to minus infinity, it goes to gamma 0. And you use this moduli space, well, the moduli space that's zero dimensional, to define this differential on the symplectic chain complex. So d of sc star m, that to itself is given precisely by d gamma. So yeah, actually you do have a condition on J that I forgot to mention before. So you want the vector, the tangent vector in R direction to map to the Reib vector field on the contact manifold.
Yeah. Second question. So
yeah.
Do you have any conditions on F?
Yeah. Okay, so actually what you need here is basically a perturbation locally around these periodic orbits of H. So first of all, you can take F to be bounded, and to have compact support, well, contained in a neighborhood of these periodic orbits. I mean, you have infinitely many of these periodic orbits, but only around these periodic orbits is where you define F to be non-zero. Yeah.
I don't understand why perturbation solves the problem of the S1 family.
Oh, because it depends on T. S1. Okay. So as you can imagine, this squares to zero, and this gives us the symplectic cohomology of M. So SH star M is defined to be precisely and so now note that in the compact case, where M is a compact manifold, the Hamiltonian pleuromology is isomorphic to the underlying homology or cohomology. And in the open case, this isn't necessarily the case. We can get something that differs largely from the homology or cohomology of the underlying manifold. Okay. So there's this theorem by Viterbo or Avondando-Lajoie that states that this symplectic cohomology, in the case of a cotangent bundle, is isomorphic to the homology of the loop space of the zero section. So, should I write that down or should I? Okay. So, SH star T star Q. And here we take the canonical symplectic form. This is isomorphic to H star Q, where LQ is the free loop space of the zero section.
Now, just to be obvious, but why cotangent bundle comes in this part of this picture? Why do you have this open end? How does it?
Okay, so you take the unit disk bundle,
of course.
And then you
implement the disk.
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
So there is like, can you return on something like reading symplectic cohomology to the wrapped cohomology of the diagonal?
I don't know that
so I mean
relation.
That, so you could say that the symplectic cohomology of M. Like the wrapped formology of the diagonal with itself.
Okay.
Times of n times n.
Okay.
Which is reminds you of like the Hochschild homology of the derived categories, because there it's taking like the x of the diagonal sheaf. So
then Kapak's case, this gives you just the homological.
Yes.
But then this is just a
these definitions are almost the same. I mean, kind of, they are.
So yeah.
This is a special case of that.
Okay. So now I'd like to define the closed open map. So what we do is we define a chain map, or the closed open map is a chain map. CO. And this maps the symplectic chain complex of M into the wrapped Fleur complex of a chosen Lagrangian K. So K is an object of the wrapped Fleur complex.
Any
object.
And for any object you have this map.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. And so we pick chain in here. Pick another co-chain in here. So this is given by a periodic orbit. And here we have a Hamiltonian chord, X, with boundary on K. And now we consider maps of the disk with one puncture at 1 and another puncture at 0. So here, S is defined to be D about 0, 1. Okay. And we look at maps U that map into.
When you remove the pointer interval,
Ah, and we remove two points. So we remove the interior point and the boundary point. Yeah, okay. And so we want U to be asymptotic to the periodic orbit at the origin, and we want U to map this puncture to the Hamiltonian chord on K.
Puncture means complement to this.
Exactly. Sorry. So this drawing isn't very good. Okay. So basically, if I allow myself to make a bad drawing, we're looking at such maps. Okay. Yeah. Is this clear? What goes on? Okay. Excuse me?
Weren't you looking at maps in the opposite direction
before? Yeah, that's actually the next. That's the open-close map. So we have the closed-open, the open-closed. Okay. Yeah.
I didn't understand which part of the boundary should go to the coordinates.
This puncture here.
But you drew long strips before.
Oh, OK. So we'll take this.
Ah, I see.
There, it might be. OK. OK.
What I said before is just a geometric argument. So I mean, this is sort of, you can put the two things together, but now, the two are from the homology.
Between the two homology.
Now, yep. Both sides there most probably are rings. Multiplication.
Oh, yeah.
Does this map then not compatible?
This is compatible with multiplication, yeah. So actually, this map extends to an algebra homomorphism from the symplectic homology of M into the Hochschild cohomology of the Rapp-Foucault category. But for the purpose of the talk, all we need is this chain map on cohomology level. Okay, so as usual, we define the moduli space XY of such, yeah? This is just cohomology, because we're only taking one object. So we're going to show the generation criterion for every object separately. But in general, you have an algebra map, closed map, from cohomology into the Hochschild cohomology. Okay. So we define this moduli space, which is exactly what we expect it to be. We take, we choose an almost complex structure on the disk, and we look at perturbed J holomorphic disks that satisfy these asymptotic boundary conditions, and such that the boundary is mapped to K. There we go. Okay. And so for generic choices of almost complex structure, we get a smooth manifold, and this has precisely it has dimension degree of X minus degree of Y. I didn't say anything about the degree of Y, but that's given, it's a shift of the Colony-Zehnder index, which I would also not like to explain at the moment. Okay, so we just define closed open map of, we'll see, of Y is then precisely the sum over the number of elements in the moduli space MXY times X, okay, where here X has the correct degree so that this moduli space has dimension zero. Oh yeah, and the proof that this closed open map is a chain map is given by by considering the Gromov compactification of these moduli spaces. So maybe I'll write that down. Chain map. And the proof is just...
What does it mean that it's a chain map? It means it's differential.
Yeah.
What's the statement?
It's a chain map. So, okay. So C0 with delta is equal to mu1 composing C0. Okay. And so the idea of the proof is precisely Gromov compactness. Of these moduli spaces M. And we see that they compactify precisely in the way that we want them to. Well, maybe I can draw a picture of this. So we get two boundary points that are of interest, namely so this is one possible boundary point, and the other possible boundary point is given, yeah, cool. Okay. So this boundary points on the left-hand side correspond precisely to terms here in the composition of the symplectic cohomology differential with the closed open map. And boundary terms on the right-hand side correspond precisely to terms in this composition. Okay. So, yeah. Let's see, how much time do I have? Not much time. I have 1.5 hours, right?
You have 1.5 hours.
Okay. Okay, so now we have the open-closed map.
Now, why one is closed open and the other
open-closed? We'll consider this cohomology to be the closed case.
I see. Okay.
Because whenever you have something Lagrangian, then you consider that to be the open case.
Okay.
Like open Gromov-Witten invariants and closed Gromov-Witten invariants. Okay, so here we define a chain map. OC. This goes from the Hochschild chain complex VB into the symplectic complex C of M. Okay.
Where B is any subcategory.
B is any subcategory of the Rapp-Fukaya category. Yes. Okay. So let me quickly write out what the maps of order D look like. So OCD, this goes from the wrapped Pleur complex LD minus 1, LD, times L0, L1, D. Okay. And so here we considered disks.
No, I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Yeah.
What's the connection between second line and first line? You want to have rapture. So what is...
Oh, wait a sec, what am I doing? Oh, sorry. This is... I got the Hochschild complex mixed up. This is SC star of M. Okay. Sorry. So once again, we consider disks, and now we have multiple punctures on the boundary and one interior puncture. So this is S, is just the disk, without Z is 0, Z is D. Okay. And we also take out the interior point, 0. So let's call this Z is D. No, no. Z is 1. D minus 1. And now we consider maps from this disk. That map as follows. So the interior point gets mapped to a periodic orbit in the symplectic complex. Let's take here y. And now let's take moments PD. And well, maybe in order to keep this drawing more or less understandable, we want these punctured boundary points to map to these chords here, PD, P1, PD minus 1, these chords that lie in these Raptor complexes. Okay. And so, as before, we choose perturbation data on the disk, we choose an almost complex structure, and we can define moduli spaces corresponding to these chains. So just write this one. Okay. And so all these chains, they come with degrees, and we can express the dimension of this moduli space in terms of the degrees. Okay, so then we define OCD of these points PD up until P1 to be precisely the number of points together with the sign lying in this moduli space.
The claim is that all these give you some kind of map of infinity structure.
Yeah, precisely. So it is a chain map. Okay, so. So OC composed with B is equal to the differential on the symplectic complex composed with OC. Okay. So we have a chain map. And as usual, one shows the statement by looking at the Gromov compactification of these moduli spaces. And one sees that, well, maybe if you look at this picture, what can happen is we can get strip breaking here along the cylinder. This would correspond precisely to terms on the right-hand side of the equation. And what can also happen is we can have disks, well, basically a disk breaking off, which would correspond to terms on the left-hand side of the equation of the Hochschild differential. Okay. And so now I'd like to. Yeah.
You said disk breaking off is the same as in this left board or something
else? Disk breaking in the sense that this disk here now can have multiple punctures on the boundary.
Yeah, so the break is each puncture separately or?
Oh, no. So you would get something like this. And then you have another disk here. And then you have multiple punctures on the disk. Okay. Okay.
What?
This delta?
No, S
Oh, sorry, this is the Hochschild differential. Oh, it's B. Sorry. But if you want, I can choose C. Okay. So I think after all this preparation, I think I can give you a sketch of the proof of Abouzaid's generation criterion. Okay. Abouzaid. Okay. So we want to show that. So, okay, we take an object K in the Rapp-Foucault category, and so B is a subcategory of this Rapp-Foucault category, and we want to show that B split generates K. Okay.
Generate under this condition.
Oh. The condition, yeah, that this, okay, maybe. So if HH star of B, if this map here, if this hits the identity in symplectic cohomology, then this shows that the subcategory B split generates the element K. Okay. Okay. Okay, so what we do is we consider the Yonad embedding of K as a W module. YK is also is a right W module. And, okay, so. So we can look at the map. From the category of W modules, which goes into the category of B modules. And also the same on the other side. Okay. And so now we look at the images of these Yonad modules under this map. We denote the images. As follows. So we say Y B KL is precisely the image of this Yonada module associated to K in this category here. And YB KR is the image of this Yonada module in this category here. Not B. Okay?
Image under this map.
Excuse me?
Image under this open closed map.
No, no.
Image
under this restriction map.
Okay,
so you just restrict from. Okay. Okay, so. Okay. So now we take the tensor product of these two B modules. And so this tensor product is now a chain complex. And so this chain complex. Yeah. Somebody ask a question?
Yeah.
you lose the B-module structure. So that's why it becomes a chain complex. If you would take the tensor product of YBR, tensor YBL, then you would get a BB module, a B bimodule. So this is a chain complex. We can take the cohomology. And one can define a map using the composition in the original category to the wrapped Fleur cohomology of K. So on chain level, one can define such a map by using these composition maps in the original wrapped Foucault category. And yeah, so this gives us a map on cohomology. And the reason we need this is because there's a lemma which states split generation precisely in terms of this map.
So what is this map again?
I could write it down on chain level if it's...
You call that mu?
It's mu, so you write down the chain complex, and then using the composition maps in the wrapped Foucault category, you can define a map that goes into the wrapped Fleur complex of K with itself. No, it's not going to become explicit.
So this uses all the different...
This uses all the composition maps.
Okay.
That exactly.
So, I mean, that chain complex on the left is one big chain of morphisms, and you just stick it into mu, and it...
So basically...
One big chain of morphisms...
With K on the left and K on the right, and then you collapse everything. So now we have the following lemma, namely, if the identity, so in this cohomology, we have an identity, if this lies in the image of this map, then the subcategory B split generates this object K. So this is purely homological algebra and has nothing to do with any structures whatsoever on the wrapped Foucault category. Excuse me?
So this should be true for any...
This is true for any category, yes. Precisely. Yeah. And so now we relate this with the wrapped Foucault category. And this is given by the following proposition. Namely, we have a commuting diagram that goes from the Hochschild homology of the subcategory B with coefficients in itself into precisely H star YB K R. Am I getting this right, or am I getting this wrong? I'm sorry, I made a mistake here. This is supposed to be the right module. Excuse me. This maps down via this map mu And here we have a map into the set eclectic cohomology of M. This is the open-closed map. This is the closed open map. Okay. And here, I didn't explain this, but this is a map given by co-product structure on the Foucault category. And the claim is that this diagram commutes. Okay. And so with the assumption, well, we have the assumption that the image of symplectic cohomology, the identity of symplectic cohomology lies in the image of this map. And we know that this map here maps the identity to the identity in the Fleur, in the Rapp-Fleur cohomology of K. So via the assumption, we know that the identity lies in the image of the map, which then means that we can apply the lemma to gain split generation of this object K by the subcategory B. Okay. So how much time do I have left?
Well, we started around 2:20.
Okay. So maybe let me try to give a sketch of an idea of the proof of why this is a commutative diagram.
Wait, so the bottom map is unital in some sense?
It is unital, yeah. Okay. So if we look at the maps in the simplest case, we'll take the smallest order of these maps, then we have the following picture. So this is very heuristic. So the map HH star delta, what it does is it counts, in the simplest case, it counts perturbed, well, J holomorphic disks with two incoming punctures and two outgoing punctures. Okay. The map mu, which is just, okay. It's very, very, very heuristic because I just want to convey the idea. Okay. So this map here, if we go down the chain level,
yes,
and look at basically the smallest part of the chains,
yes,
we have two complexes. And the degree, well, I mean, no, this map maps these two complexes into two complexes here, precisely. Two Fleur complexes here.
Yeah.
Into, yeah, two Fleur complexes here. Okay. Here.
In Hochschild homology
B? Yeah.
Just have one.
Well, you have two inputs, don't you? Wait. What am I getting wrong here? Okay.
Length 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, but if you have length, wait. So, okay. So you're saying we only have one input here?
But when, I mean, that would be the simplest.
Okay. Well then, okay. So, well then, let's look in the next simplest case where you have two inputs, because then you can construct a kind of a geometric homotopy in this case. Well, you can just show this geometrically. So H star mu is just our usual composition. And here you have two inputs, minus, and one output. So in the open-close case, we look precisely at J holomorphic disks in the simplest case with two inputs and one output. So this corresponds to the generator in simplex cohomology, and these are precisely the chains in Fleur complexes. And so now H star C0. Here we look at disks or perturbed J holomorphic disks with one input and one output. Okay. And so the idea is now to define a map that goes from the Hochschild homology of B with coefficients in itself directly to the Fleur cohomology of K. So this homotopy map H is a homotopy, and H goes from C C star beta into C W star K K. Okay, and this homotopy is given precisely by looking at perturbed J holomorphic annuli. And the idea is that we can define moduli spaces of such pseudo-holomorphic annuli with multiple inputs on the lower boundary and one output on the upper boundary. And by looking at the Gromov of compactification of these moduli spaces, we should get precisely a homotopy between the composition of these maps. So, yeah. Maybe I should write this down somewhere. Exactly, yeah, precisely. So, CO composed of OC plus minus U composed of delta is then orient plus minus, and then you take H composed of B plus minus. So maybe I'll repeat quickly. So once again, with this homotopy, which is defined by looking at such pseudo-holomorphic annuli, we can look at the one-dimensional moduli spaces here. And we see that under the Gromov of compactification at these boundary points, we get precisely terms that correspond to these terms here, which give us a homotopy between these two maps. And so this proves that this diagram is commutative. And together with the lemma, we get the split generation criterion. So,
does it make sense to maybe slightly so you can generate this annulus so that it splits in the middle, and that will give
exactly.
you the H
star
so C with the
I'll draw it like this. So here, so these two. Exactly.
Now, can you draw the upper one?
The upper one is kind of special. So what you want is that you want to have these boundary conditions on the annulus. And so that amounts to looking at something like this. So this is the first disk, and here. And this is composed with this disk, which is just the usual composition. Okay. So this way we get, so we see that on this boundary here, well, I mean, we have two, this corresponds to precisely to these two input points on the lower boundary, and we have one output point on the upper boundary. So that's how we get the breaking. Okay.
So you always have two in the middle because you're going to at least bi module thing. And that corresponds to the two intersection points you get from the
current. Exactly.
You squeeze the, I mean, maybe like you should show you're squeezing there because it's really about okay. Visualizing the polarization.
So.
Like, you squeeze the top and the bottom together.
There.
So that's one way to do it, but to get the top picture, you have to like take two different points on the up and.
Okay, so if you look at the annulus from above and assume that the bottom has a larger diameter than the top, then you would get something like this. And then now you basically squeeze along these two lines here, and this corresponds precisely to. Yeah, these. I have to look at the input points. Sorry, this is a bad drawing. Okay.
On the inside.
Oh. One on the inside, right? Okay.
I'm twisted because of the
boundary. Because of the boundary conditions. Because, yeah, you want two points on the bottom boundary and one point on the top boundary. And that's why you have to twist the picture. Okay. So that's basically the idea of, yeah, of the theorem.
So thanks, Cedric.
Okay.